Good morning, brothers and sisters. Thank you for joining us this Sunday for our chapel service. My name is Sam Sandoval, and I'm an elder at Fellowship Church Rouge Park. It is a pleasure to have you join us today. We will get into worship, and I do have a passage of scripture that I'd like to read. Before I do that, I would just like to mention that we are having prayer meetings Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays from 7:30 to 8:30 on our Google Meets. Please join us if you're available. We also continue to do our small groups, and we continue to pray for each other. I know I miss you, and I hope we can get together soon. Let us know how we could serve you, if you have any needs, how we could pray with you. Please message us through our website and get in touch. If there's anything that we can do, how we can help, we'd love to do that for you. Here we have chapter 67 of Psalms. If you could turn there, it reads, "May God be gracious to us and bless us and make his face to shine upon us, that your way may be known on earth, your saving power among all nations. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Let the nations be glad and sing for joy. For you judge the peoples with equity and guide the nations upon earth. Let the peoples praise you, O God, and let all the peoples praise you. The earth has yielded its increase, God. Our God shall bless us. God shall bless us. Let all the ends of the earth fear him." Let's pray before we get into worship. Heavenly Father, I just thank you that you have given us yourself, that you are a reward, that we call you Father. To us who have put our trust and faith in Jesus, you have adopted us, you have freed us and given us freedom from sin, freedom from death, and we have life in Jesus. And you bless us. And I pray, Heavenly Father, that it's through your blessing and through your love that we are able to show blessing and love to each other and to the world, that we would be different and be a light and be like Christ, and so that the world would see and everyone around would see that we belong to you, that we are your children, and that you would receive glory, that your name would be lifted up, Father God, and that your word would go out with power, and that we would be led by the Spirit to be more Christ-like and show the love you've shown us to others so that your name would be glorified. Bless us, Lord God, your family, your children. We need you. You are our Father. And we praise you and we give you glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Do not fail. but thy compassions they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth, thy own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Hi everyone, welcome again. It's good to be with you through our YouTube channel. And I also recognize that today is Mother's Day and want to take a moment to say that I am very grateful and I thank God for mothers and the gift that they are to us. Even as I watch my own wife help raise our children, And as moms point their children to Christ, what a wonderful opportunity. And so happy and a blessed Mother's Day to those of you who are, and those of you who are like spiritual moms to many of us. I'm grateful for you as well, how you've poured into my life and others in the life of the church. And so today we're going to look at Genesis 33. So I invite you to read with me these verses together, and we will pray and we will look at what God has to say from this text. Okay, so join me as we look at Genesis 33. And Jacob lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, Esau was coming, and 400 men with him. So he divided the children among Leah and Rachel and two female servants. And he put the servants with their children in front, then Leah with her children, and Rachel and Joseph last of all. He himself went on before them, bowing himself to the ground seven times, until he came near to his brother. But Esau ran to meet him and embraced him and fell on his neck and kissed him. And they wept. When Esau lifted his eyes and saw the women and children, he said, "Who are these with you?" Jacob said, "The children whom God has graciously given to your servant." Then the servants drew near and their children and bowed down. Leah likewise and her children drew near and bowed down. And last Joseph and Rachel drew near and they bowed down. Esau said, "What do you mean by all this company that I met? And Jacob answered, "To find favor in the sight of my Lord." And Esau said, "I have enough, my brother. Keep what you have for yourself." Jacob said, "No, please, if I have found favor in your sight, then accept my present from my hand. For I have seen your face, which is like seeing the face of God. And you have accepted me. Please accept my blessing that is brought to you, because God has dealt graciously with me, and because I have enough." Thus he urged him, and he took it. Then Esau said, "Let us journey on our way, and I will go ahead of you." But Jacob said to him, "My Lord knows that the children are frail, and the nursing flocks and the herds are a care to me. And if they are driven hard for one day, all the flocks will die. Let my Lord pass ahead of a servant, and I will lead on slowly at the pace of the livestock that are ahead of me and at the pace of the children until I come to my Lord in Seir." So Esau said, "Let me leave with you some of the people who are with me." But he said, "What need is there? Let me find favor in the sight of my Lord." So Esau returned that day on his way to Seir, but Jacob journeyed to Succoth, and he built himself a house and made booths for his livestock. Therefore the name of that place is called Succoth. Jacob came safely to the city of Shechem, which is in the land of Canaan, on his way to Padanaram, and he camped before the city. And from the sons of Hamor, Shechem's father, he bought 400 pieces of money, 100 pieces of money, the piece of land which on which he pitched his tent. There he erected an altar called El Eloi Israel. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your kindness to us. We pray now, Lord, that you would take this and that you would speak to us. You would draw us near to you. And that you would, Lord, strengthen your people. You would open our eyes. And you would cause us to respond to you in joy. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. We often don't have to look far to see where there have been hurt or strange relationships in our lives. In fact, if we think back as far as memory can take us, I think we'll remember where there have been friendships or family relationships that have been dysfunctional. I remember as a kid realizing that in some sense. In fact, that could be us right now with dysfunctional relationships. And the reasons can be manifold. But the point remains that living in a fallen world brings about broken relationships. To some, there are many. To others, there are few. But I find in most cases that these things tend to rift the relationships. They're deep and long-standing. Such is the case in today's passage. A long-standing rift within the immediate family among two brothers. Even so, in situations of deep relational rift, there is nothing greater than seeing a long, lifelong conflict come to a healing moment, a happy resolution. So as we journey through this text, I want us to consider what's at the heart of this text. And that's this. So I'm going to lay it out for you. God's people enjoy His blessing through reconciliation. God's people enjoy blessing through reconciliation. You know, today's passage gives us one of the most beautiful stories of reconciliation between two people, not just in the book of Genesis, but in all of the Old Testament. You see, reconciliation brings peace. And where there's peace, there's life and there's unity. In fact, the psalmist in Psalm 133, verse 1, put it this way. Behold, how good and pleasant it is when brothers dwell in unity. Behold, how good and pleasant it is when brothers dwell in unity. I don't know if David had Jacob and Esau in mind, but it is beautiful and good. For Jacob, this has been a 21-year journey. You see, his last memory of his brother was one where he stole his blessing, and his brother was probably sharpening his knife and his axe, saying that he's going to kill him, that Jacob was a wanted man, and Esau was going to kill him for stealing his blessing from his father. And so, I don't blame Jacob, who had not heard from his brother all these years. After all, they were a few thousand years behind on emails and phone calls and social media. They haven't heard a bit from each other. See, 2 weeks back, we looked at what transpired at the end of Genesis 32, where Jacob met with God in an unexpected way and experienced God in a supernatural way, and it changed him, yet in a painful way. You see, God plus Jacob supernaturally and spiritually, yet he dislocated him physically in his hip. And because of that, Jacob now walked with a limp for the rest of his life. And so as Jacob walked with a cane to support his walk to make progress into the land of promise, it becomes a picture. It serves us as a reminder how all of us need to lean and trust in God to make progress in our own life. And this has been 24 hours at the end of 32 to the beginning of chapter 33. And Jacob's life has changed forever. So as we pursue this text, I want us to look at three things. The number one, the main thing we're going to talk about, spend the most amount of time, is the first point. The last two really serve us as point of application. Here's the first one. Despite our weakness, God is able to bring about reconciliation as a mean of blessing. Despite our weakness, God is able to bring reconciliation as a means of blessing. We see this in the first 11 verses. You know, clearly this narrative has been carefully recorded in such a way to create a sense of anticipation. You go through chapter 32 and you wonder, what's going to happen now? What is God going to do in the life of Jacob? How is this going to get resolved? So let me read for you again the first three verses and think about this together. Jacob lifted his eyes and looked, and behold, Esau was coming and 400 men with him. So he divided his children among Leah and Rachel and the two female servants. And he put the servants with their children in front, then Leah with her children and Rachel and Joseph last of all. He himself went on before them, bowing himself to the ground 7 times until he came near to his brother. So it's obvious that Jacob is still a planner, that he's trying to do his part. mindful of the details, doing everything he can, and ultimately leaving the outcome to God's hands. It reminds us that the Bible does not tell us to just pray and do nothing. But more so, it instructs us to pray and do our part, what we are responsible for, and trust God for the outcome. Because he's the one who has the final word and say in everything. See, Jacob is no longer greatly afraid and distressed as described in the previous chapter. He now enters the scene with renewed faith and yet still humility. You know, it reminds me, recently our kids and I watched Pilgrim's Progress by John Bunyan. And if you haven't read the book or watched this new animation, I encourage you to watch it and read it. It's really helpful. At one point in the story, the main character, Christian, is told that he has to walk the straight and narrow by another character named Evangelist. And he warns him, he says, when you arrive to this scene, you'll see two lions, but you must walk through them. And with fear and trembling, Christian walks close to them. And as he walks really close, he realizes that they're both chained to the pillar. That they can't really ultimately destroy him. God has kept them at a particular distance. You see, there are limits that God establishes. And the same is true for Jacob. God has gone ahead and established the limits on the things that Jacob had feared the most. In this case, his brother. For Jacob, Esau may seem like the lion that Christian faced in Pilgrim's Progress. At least that was his recollection 21 years ago. But he must stay the course and trust the God who blessed him in the previous chapter. Trust the God who called him to go ahead into the land of promise. You see, God had made a promise to bless him and bless the nations, and he will keep his word. So Jacob approaches his brother in humility, bowing 7 times. This depicts almost as one enters a royal court and bows himself down. Yet, how does Esau respond to all of this? The opposite way, actually. Esau does not follow any royal ideas of bowing. In fact, we read in verse 4 that Esau ran to meet him and embraced him and fell on his neck and kissed him, and they wept. This right here is an incredible scene in all of Genesis. Right here. Esau eagerly ran to Jacob with delight and embraced him. They hugged and they cried together. It has been 21 long years that they have not seen one another. What a wonderful moment as they looked at each other. I paused at this moment as I read this to consider the relief, the tears, and the joy that this caused them. You see, I wondered, in these years, when they got up in the mornings and they thought of each other, what they would have thought of them. I wonder what he's doing. I wonder what he's doing. I'm so angry at him. I wonder if he's still angry at me. Well, all of those questions have been answered now. God has certainly done a thing. You see, for Jacob, having seen God, now he sees his brother in a whole new light. God has touched him, and now he sees his brother very differently. And this is part of the miracle of the gospel. When God saves and changes us and restores us, we're able to live again with peace and harmony with one another. That is the aim. God has fought his battle of fear and anxiety and distress. And now he's given him peace and brotherly affection. It hasn't happened overnight. It took 21 years. But God does not change. God has been faithful. You see, there is no such thing as a saved person who hates his brother. We're not to hate. In fact, 1 John 4:20, it says this: if anyone says, I love God, and hates his brother, he's a liar. For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not seen. Friends, if we really have met God and experienced his grace, you and I will be changed forever. We're not perfect, but we will be changed. Those who have been saved by the grace of God must know that we cannot hold a grudge and withhold forgiveness and maintain bitterness. We cannot fail to forgive. Those faces that once looked like enemies now look like sons and daughters of God. When you wrestle with God in the flesh, it changes you forever, the way you look at other people and yourself. So God has done a work in Jacob's life, but it is also clear that he has done a work in Esau's heart. We don't know when, but he has. And so Jacob rejoices, and so should we. This moment in biblical narrative is really important. It is a place where we see guilt and forgiveness so eloquently moving towards each other, and when they meet, it gives birth to reconciliation. Guilt and forgiveness coming together and giving birth to reconciliation. That is beautiful. Not only has the Lord been working away in Jacob's life, but also at Esau's. Jacob had thought that this meeting with his brother was the crisis at hand. But for Jacob, the crisis has been really his relationship with God, with his self-dependency, self-sufficiency. God has been moving and changing him to become God-dependency. So we should note that the same is true for all of us. We can too easily spend too much time trying to argue and figure out how to outsmart the other person, how to shift blame, how to minimize our sin. All the while, God has been calling us for our attention and telling us that this is one of the primary ways he changes us, through relationships and reconciliation. He's not done with us. But there's one primary thing that often keeps us back from the work of reconciliation in our own lives, first towards God and then towards one another. And that's this: pride. Human pride says, no, I'm at the center. I'm not right. I'm not wrong. I am right. And so pride often comes in the way. And this can go both ways, by the way, both for the offended and the offender. Both of us can live and respond in pride. You see, in humility, Jacob had sent gifts to his brother Esau. And we read in verse 8, and Esau said, what do you mean by all this company that I meet? And Jacob answered, to find favor in the sight of my Lord. See, in Genesis 27, as I mentioned previously, Jacob had deceived his brother Esau and took his blessing. And so Jacob can't really give that blessing back now, because that's God's blessing for him. But Esau did not demand retribution or compensation for what was lost. Rather, Esau experienced genuine joy in seeing his brother as he wept and kissed him. See, verse 10, Jacob says that seeing his brother was like seeing the face of God. What does that mean? Well, Jacob has seen God the day before. Jacob has been blessed by God. And seeing Jacob hug and kiss him and be restored to him is seeing God at work, even in the life of Esau. A favorable reaction says to him, this is like seeing the face of God once again, because God is graciously dealing with him. Only now it was through his brother. So God has turned human error into a blessing. It was costly. It took a long time, but God did not forsake him. You know, in the scene, as we step back for a moment and as we look at this, we can observe an undercurrent in this passage. We see a significant emphasis on the idea of grace. Let me give you some examples. Jacob urges Esau to accept the gift in order to find grace. The family possessions were God's grace to Jacob. Jacob wanted Esau's forgiveness, asking for grace. Jacob's attempt to give out of God's bounty to gain Esau's grace. And Jacob says, if I have found favor, grace in your sight. See, it serves to remind us that the heart of reconciliation is the grace of God, which enables us to experience God's goodness in reconciliation. Now, Some of you may be thinking, I don't have any major rift in my family or even my social relationships. You know, reconciliation is not just simply reserved for major issues. We must start with minor ones in order to deal with major ones. You know, if you can't run a lap on the 400 meter track, forget trying to run 5 laps. Likewise, if we're not serious about dealing with small hurts and misunderstandings in our relationships, we will not be equipped to deal with major rifts in our relationships. You know, we should seek to be reconciled even after small things that happen. After all, small things build up to become major things over time. You know, and most issues in a relationship tend to arise out of everyday mundane things that we do not address. We become a little careless with our words, with our tone, with our body language, and over the years, it tends to erupt over time like a volcano. Let me give you a real life example that I was guilty of. I was in a rush one day, feeling pressure to get stuff done, running to a meeting, a lot of things on my plate. And on the way out, trying to have a conversation with my wife, and I failed to consider my lack of kindness. I failed to consider my tone of voice. I failed to consider my body language. It wasn't anything, you know, evil or blatantly hurtful, but they were small things. And so as I was driving, clearly the Holy Spirit convicts my conscience that I was sinning. I wasn't careful. I wasn't being kind. So now, what do I do when I go back home? I return home, give you an example, and my wife is busy. She's doing something with the kids, doing something important. And I walk back and I say, not really looking in her eyes, I say, hey, I'm sorry about what happened earlier. Was that day to go about it? No. I fail to consider how I ought to really be reconciled in that situation. If I just go back and I say, hey, I'm sorry for earlier, I'm really wasting her time and her energy. Here's why. I fail to wait until we can actually be alone. We can have undistracted time. I failed to own my sin and be specific about what happened. I'm just giving you a simple scenario here, but this is true even for bigger issues. So as a form of application, let me share for you with a few helpful ways, not that I discovered it, but things that I've observed from other people in my life. Older saints, some who've gone to glory with the Lord right now. Things that I've learned from them, things that are clearly biblical in the way we ought to seek reconciliation, even over small things. So three simple applications here. Number one, when seeking to reconcile, first and foremost, I must pray. I must pray over my heart. Ask the Lord to help me die to my pride, to my being defensive, to me minimizing my sin. I must pray for God's love and grace to enable me and the other person to have this conversation, so the Lord may be glorified, and so that I may mature, we may mature through this. Secondly, I want to seek an uninterrupted time. Not when the kids are running around, because the kids already saw my bad example when I say something careless, when I act carelessly. So I want to seek a time when we actually can be not be interrupted. We can just talk face to face, look each other in the eyes and talk about this. Not just where I get it off my chest and walk away. And I want to invite them during that time to ask questions and clarify. Third, and I find this is very important, be specific. See, when I'm trying to reconcile and own my sin, I need to be able to say, this is what I did and what I said, and be specific. It's easy to call up somebody and say, hey, I'm sorry for hurting you if I did. Okay, bye. That does nothing good. That doesn't honor the Lord. But owning up and being specific helps us move forward and make progress. You see, if you are the offended party in this situation, then you need to show grace and don't stomp all over them. There's no joy in that. Remember, my bad and unthoughtful example I gave you earlier, I just go back and I say, hey, I'm sorry. Well, maybe a more godly way of doing this would be something like this. Honey, I am sorry for the way I spoke. I'm sorry for the tone. And I'm sorry about my body language. I want to be specifics. I'm sorry that I didn't show love to you, didn't honor the Lord, and it wasn't a good example to the children. Would you forgive me? I want to be specifics about that. Because through that, in God's help, I gain our relationship back. And there's joy restored all of a sudden. And things change. And if at all possible, we want to pray together at the end of that conversation. And we want to enjoy each other's presence once again. That's what's happening to Jacob and Esau in this moment. They are enjoying each other's presence, maybe for the first time, actually. I think they had rivalries growing up because of favoritism from mom and dad. But now, mom and dad are not there with them. There's true reconciliation. Now, if you need to do this with someone, I encourage you to start praying and be intentional and reach out to them. Or maybe you've done this with someone, and as you're thinking through this, you realize, you know, I think I really rushed that. I think I really did that reconciliation in sort of a minute. It was one-sided. I got it out of my chest, and I walked away. Can I encourage you? Go back. Own up your sin. Be specific. Let them ask you a question. Pray with them. And be reconciled. That honors the Lord. It's not too late to do it right again for the glory of God and your joy. Remember that reconciliation is a process of us dying to ourselves and living unto Christ. Dietrich Bonhoeffer put it this way. He says, when Christ calls a man, he bids him to come and die to self. And he was surely right. Genuine reconciliation is costly to our pride, to who we think we are, but it is sweet and precious. I'll say that again. Genuine reconciliation is costly, most of all, to our pride, but it is sweet and precious. You see, the Lord Jesus said that all people will know his disciples by their love for one another in John 13:35. The most tangible expression of this love is our forgiveness of others, that Christ is in us. I've observed over the years, Christians who sadly do not want to forgive others, even for the most minor offenses. Somehow we end up thinking that it's an option, but we fail to realize it's a clear command. And if we keep living that way, you got to ask yourself, where is the Holy Spirit in all of this? If God is in me, then I will bear the fruit of that in my life. Not perfection. But we do see the fruit of the Spirit in us and through us. Brothers and sisters, what better time than now? We're isolated. We're in our homes. We got time in our hands to seek the Lord in prayer and even ask God with this. Lord, would you reveal to me relationships that I need to work on, where I need to pray, where I need to reach out and be reconciled? Would you help me, Lord? And then maybe reach out to a brother or sister, help you in that process, to pray with you, walk with you. If you're a member of our church, as elders, we'd be happy to walk with you and speak with you on this matter. But this is important. It is not an option. It's a command. And it should be a joyful thing for us, ultimately. Perhaps you have backslidden away from the Lord. And as a result, you have gone far from Him. See, friend, God delights to bring home the exiles, those who have gone far. And if that's you, turn back to Him today. And God will receive you. See, relationships are always more God-honoring and joyful when we seek reconciliation with God first, and then with one another. If you're not a Christ follower, friend, reconciliation is at the heart of God's message to this fallen world. You see, today's passage, we see, as I mentioned earlier, guilt and forgiveness coming together eloquently. And when they met, it gives birth to reconciliation. Our need for our vertical Reconciliation with God always precedes our horizontal reconciliation with one another. You see, God is calling us to look to Him and put our trust in Him. It is only when we are reconciled to God that we can truly make sense of this life and our relationships with the one another's. Outside of that, we'll always be left frustrated, trying to make things work on our own strength and in our own ways. Apart from Him, we're left in our flawed and broken ways. The same God who graciously showed grace and mercy to Jacob is calling you to look to Him. In 2 Corinthians 5:19, God says this, "In Christ, God was reconciling the world to Himself, not counting their trespasses, their sins, against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation." God delights in saving sinners, but we must first see ourselves as sinners who are living life on our own terms. We must see that God is worthy and we are needy, and God is holding out His hands, inviting us to come and receive Him and confess our sins and trust Him. See, in His great love, He's reaching out to sinful humanity. In humility, we must receive Him. Or in pride, we will reject Him. I pray that you will receive Him in humility and rejoice. Now, a part of reconciliation involves speaking honest truth so our conscience is clear. So I have two brief points to support our main idea as a form of application. And that's this: in times of reconciliation, God's people must seek wise counsel and not deception. We see that work out in verses 12 to 17. You see, we're seeing an ensuing dialogue with Esau and Jacob. Esau offers to help, to journey back with Jacob to Seir. And Jacob responds by saying, "No, I have these flock and I have young children and I can't, and I don't want to put them in danger." You see, it seems like in verse 13, Jacob is giving them an excuse. And so Esau took his word for it and he left. And Esau's offer seemed genuine. See, Jacob's desire to return to the promised land indicates that God's grace is with him. However, his deeds reveal that grace has not fully perfected him, just like us. You see, regardless of Jacob's motivation here, the old Jacob has a tendency, as we remember, to be self-sufficient. When he gets uncomfortable with what's before him, that he must go to the land of promise where God specifically called him. You see, playing fast and loose with the truth, even to accomplish God's purposes, will have its consequences. We will see that in the next chapter. But this serves to remind us that sometimes we take two steps forward in our progress and one step backwards. This is the reality in our growth in holiness, our sanctification. See, unlike justification, where it is God's once and for all declaration that we are righteous through Christ in His sight, sanctification is a process and there are no shortcuts to it. See, we will not conform perfectly to our Father's gracious ways in this life. We have to work out our salvation with fear and trembling. And sometimes we cave into sin. If so, we can look to the God who is gracious and merciful. The reality of sanctification and hungering and thirsting after righteousness is like going from a daily dose of deep-fried chicken and pizza to healthy nutrition overnight. We know it's not going to be easy. You can try all kinds of diets. You can try a keto diet and try changing up your health. But we'll know that keto will try your old diets of appetites as well. In other words, if you try keto, keto will try you. Such is our battle in our call to holiness, where we're called to become more like Christ. The old self will try to push its way in. We must see that and die to that and live to Christ. God helps us in the process. See, our struggle for sanctification can leave us discouraged at times. I feel like that sometimes. But we should not lose heart, for the Lord has promised to make us holy. In this life, we must keep in mind that God uses the means of grace to make extraordinary changes in us. What are the means of grace? Prayer, His Word, our worship, our fellowship, our reconciliation. Those are means of grace that God gives us. And He uses that as a process to grow us. There is no magic bullet. Yes, I do wish there's a bucket of sanctification I can just pour my life overnight and boom, I'm a holy guy. It doesn't work that way. 21 years into my faith now, and I'm still learning, still growing. And so that doesn't change. But we can see how God is helping us make progress. Lastly, another form of application. God's people must always seek to credit God for our peace and success. We see that in verses 18 to 20 as we wrap up this text. It's easy to simply look at these last few verses and see that it's a closing statement and move on. But there's something important here. Jacob's action on the other side of reconciliation is important. Because he goes to the city of Shechem, buys a piece of land and pitches the tent here. And we read in verse 20, and there he erected an altar and called it El Eloi Israel. It's easy to say, God help me. Especially if I don't want to come off like sounding prideful. But one healthy indicator of giving God credit and glory is to be able to lead, is to be able to praise Him and worship Him. To be led into that. That's what Jacob does in the closing section here. He builds an altar and he calls El Elyon Israel, God, the God of Israel. That's his God. Jacob identifies the God of Israel, the land that is yet to be. He's in the land that's going to be the promised land. He's 400 years away from that. His people are. And he says, this is the God of Israel, this land. He worships the one who he encountered at Bethel, who's been with him all this time, who's the one who's now bringing him back to the land of promise. God has changed his name. God has brought about reconciliation. That's important for us. Brothers and sisters, we will be helped to learn from this passage. It will be healing to us and those around us. Namely, that we may seek the Lord's help in being reconciled where there is brokenness in our relationships, where there's rift and hurt. That we may seek to be honest and fight off temptation, even with small lies. Where we may be led to worship God and give Him the due glory and the honor. Why? Because God blesses His people through reconciliation. Let's pray together. Father, we thank You that You do bless us as You reconcile us to You, and then You give us the ministry of reconciliation towards one another and the world. We ask now, Lord, through Your Spirit, that You would speak to each of us. Help us consider where we need to address this in our own lives. And then, Lord, we ask that You'd empower us through Your Holy Spirit. You would equip us with wisdom and help us with Your people, that we may walk together and be a people who are walking with You and with one another, and we're seeking to bring healing into relationships through the gospel. We thank You and we praise You. In Christ's name, amen.
Fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing Thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of Thy redeeming love. Here I raise mine Ebenezer, hither by Thy help I'm come, and I hope by Thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. Oh, to grace, how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy grace, Lord, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it for thy courts above. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it for thy courts above. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it for thy courts above.
Thank you, brother, for sharing the word of God with us today. Thank you, worship team, for leading us in worship. And thank you all for joining us. I want to share before we leave from chapter 3, verse 12 to verse 15. Put on then, as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other, as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. And above all these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful. And I truly am thankful for God and for our family, which He has provided, our brothers and sisters watching. We love you, we miss you, we care for you. Please stay in touch. See you at prayer. See you in small groups. Have a great day.